please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
High point of the day for the market, and it's been so refreshing for the bulls to see the rally sustaining for some time. 0.5% higher is what we have. The mid-cap index is actually flying right now, 4:1 advanced decline ratio. And the bank Nifty as well at the high point. Ashwani Gujral and Mitesh Thakkar back with us. Ashwani, do you reckon shorts are out of the system, have been cleaned out, and is this actually a time to play long on the market?
See, we possibly are looking for a bigger and better pullback than the day before. So that way, the market looks like early morning we've started picking up. Plus, you would recall that yesterday lots of shorts were in. So from the day before pullback compared to that, today's pullback looks stronger. So chances are that you could maybe even get back to 10,180, 200. Now, whether that changes the longer term scenario, that we'll have to wait and see. But for the day, given that Bank Nifty, the Nifty's futures has crossed 10,080, 10,100, I think the trade, the short trade hasn't worked. And the idea should be to go long and hope that this pullback lasts maybe an entire day. That's possible. Even in a downtrend, you can have a full day of pullback. So that's what we are now looking at. So this is the time to get long. And if you are long and it works out, it'll give you much more money than what you lost on the short trade. As far as individual stocks are concerned, Jet Airways is a buy with a stop of 690, target of 720. Petronet LNG is a buy with a stop of 248, target of 262. And Ujjivan is a buy with a stop of 373, target of 390.
Okay, that's interesting. Ashwini, is there any specific, stocks like GAIL or Bosch, which have done very well, over 2% higher? Any of these offer a trade on the long side?
See, if we are talking about the day, then your best odds are where people went short yesterday afternoon.
Okay.
So get long on the PSU banks, etc., because apparently there has been no follow through to yesterday's short selling. And today everybody seems to be happy that it wasn't as bad as expected. So maybe those shorts cover, and by the end of the day, PSU banks could be up 2-3%.
Okay. Mitesh is also with us. So let's get Mitesh on board. Would you concur, Mitesh, that now perhaps you can cover your shorts and maybe even go long on this market for the day?
I haven't done that as yet. Okay. So I think, very clearly, I think 10,120, 130 is the reversal point on the Nifty and on the Bank Nifty. My sense is that unless until we start getting past 25,150, 200, I wouldn't really be worried. I think, after seeing the Bank Nifty fall from 25,900 to about 24,840, you always have to give some space for about 200, 300 point kind of a pullback. And even if we have that, I think I'll maintain a short bias and look at shorting around the upper end of the range. So around 2500, 150, if I get those levels in the Bank Nifty, I would be adding more to my short positions. Having said that, I have one buy and one sell call right now. GNFC is a buy with a stop at 455 for targets of 490. And that's one stock which is giving a good intraday setup. And Kotak Bank is a sell. It's a conditional sell. So let it break below levels of 997 and then go short. The stop should be around 1012 on the upside, 1014 on the upside, and 965 should be your short-term trade with that.
Okay. Well, thank you, Mitesh. Rajat Bose is also joining us now. Good morning, Rajat. What stocks are you trading at this juncture? I mean, actually, now we're seeing the mid-caps gain almost 0.2 percentage point. It suddenly turned to be extremely in favor of the bulls.
Yeah, I'm quite happy about that, and good morning. I would say I have two buy calls and one sell call. Two buy calls, one is Tech Mahindra. I would put a stop loss below 474.50. 492, 498 are the two targets, but it can even go up to 503. That may not be made in one day, but it's looking pretty bullish. KSCL, that is Kaveri Seeds, this company I would sell with a stop above December futures. I would sell with a stop above 519, 503 and 499 are the two targets. One of the weakest counters in today's trading. And Bata December futures, I would put a stop loss below 729. Stocks looking like giving a reversal. 742 and 746 are the two targets on the upside.
Okay. Ashwani, at what point would you say that the correction is over?
See, the correction will be over if you get past, say, broadly on the Nifty futures, 25,450-500, and on the Bank Nifty futures, and on the Nifty futures, I guess if you can probably reclaim 10,180 to 200,
okay,
and stay above those levels, only then you would call the correction over. Otherwise, you can have a fairly decent 100-point pullback, and it may finally mean nothing. So people should trade it like a pullback. Those who want confirmation need to wait it out and probably see what happens at 10,200.
Okay, well, gentlemen, thanks for joining us and giving us your views. We'll come back to you for final thoughts before the day ends for sure. But for now, let's shift focus. GSPL is the stock on our radar after global metal prices trade weak in Shanghai as for the second day, as an increase in global inventories has been weighing heavy on commodities. But what's happening in our own markets? Naushad Akhtar Ansari, the CEO of the steel business at GSPL, joins us now to talk about that. Mr. Ansari, good morning. What about the domestic steel market? What kind of trend do you see in prices over the next, say, 6 to 8 months?
If you could, good morning to you, and if you could see the price trend as is happening today, mm-hmm, compared to the last month, we already see that there are positive signs of the prices going up. Mm-hmm. In fact, they had dipped down a little bit, but now they are going up, and in the coming few months, we are very, very certain that the prices will go back to the earlier quarter, and you know, all this this issue which is coming because of the cost push of iron ore prices going up, and the coal prices, coking coal prices going up, is all going to lead to this higher prices of steel. And that is almost certain, because you can also see the prices going up in China. You can see the billet prices, which had dipped down a little bit in the last month or so, has again gone up. So everywhere, all the signs are very, very positive in terms of the prices going up.
Okay.
And of course, we do believe that the margins will continue to remain in the same range bound, simply because even though the prices are going up, the cost push is also there, and therefore the margins would remain in the same range.
Okay. Mr. Ansari, good morning. So if you could give some numbers in terms of how much price increase are you expecting over the next 3 to 6 months?
Yeah, I'd imagine that another 1,500 to 2,000 kind of numbers should be very much there in terms of flats, and also in terms of rebar. Also, we do expect the prices to go up. So, in the next quarter, for example, our expectation is that it should be going up in the range of 1,500 to 2,000, in that range.
But isn't there a big threat from imports if the prices are hiked exorbitantly?
But these are not exorbitant prices, because if you look at the cost push which is there from every side, and that includes all the foreign manufacturers too, the iron ore prices have already gone up, the coal prices have already gone up, the electrode prices have gone up. So everyone is feeling the impact of those increased prices. So we really, I mean, this in price increase which we are talking about would be very much justified based on the cost push which is there. And so, even the import, for example, I mean, the people who are going to export, I really do not think that they will be able to operate at prices lower than this. If you look at the import market today, in flat, for example, majority of the thing is coming primarily from the POSCO and other companies like that. It's not so much from China. And POSCO, it is coming simply because there is absolutely no import duty on that. But they are also all feeling the same issue in terms of the coking coal prices and iron ore prices. So therefore, I don't think that the number which we are talking about is anything exorbitant at all.
Okay. Well, Mr. Ansari, I wanted to ask you about JSPL itself, I mean output. We understand from some brokerage reports that any meaningful improvement in your Angul steel volumes can happen only after the basic oxygen furnace is commissioned. Is that underway? Is it getting commissioned?
You are absolutely correct that the Angul capacity increase is going to happen meaningfully only after the BOF is commissioned, and that is going to be commissioned in middle of this month. The trials are already going on, the what we call the individual function tests, etc., are already going on, and now it is a matter of few days, couple of weeks, that we should be having our commissioning process, hot commissioning should actually be starting. So yes, we are very much looking forward to that day when we actually start this BOF, which is going to happen, as I said, in the middle of December.
Okay. Well, I'm asking you about the expansions because are you getting enough liquidity from the banks after the Reserve Bank's so-called, well, it was not an AQR, but they have asked several banks to mark your loan as NPA. Is there a problem of liquidity? Are you able to finish what you planned?
Yes, I mean, I must say that the good news is that despite the higher working capital requirement and so on, simply because of our better management of working capital, we are not requiring any more debt, etc., and the debt level remains at the same level. So therefore, we really don't see any major problem at all in terms of managing what we are wanting to do. And what you mentioned about that RBI, I think this is only a technical issue, a small technical issue, which over a period of time will be absolutely get corrected. Because you need to understand today, in terms of our debt repayment as well as our interest repayment, we are totally current. There is absolutely no overdues at all. So, we are not really very much concerned or worried on that score.
Okay. So, what will be your total steel output by the end of this year? And what will that mean in terms of revenue?
See, our year is, the financial year is ending by the month of March. So if you look at it, almost, Raigarh will be operating close to, in the next quarter, Raigarh will be operating close to about 100% of its capacity. That would be roughly around 3.4, 3.5 million tons.
Okay.
And as far as Angul is concerned, of course, Angul capacity, once we commission the BOF, then technically the capacity will go up to 5 million. But in Angul, of course, as I mentioned, that even though we had started the blast furnace, but we obviously can't run the blast furnace fully without BOF. So the Angul capacity, or capacity, even though it will become 5 million, but by the end of the financial year, I would say that total Angul production will be close to about 1.3, 1.4 million tons. That's the kind of number that we are really talking about.
1.3 yes. Only? I mean, it.
No. Sorry, 1.3 in the last 6 months we are talking about.
Okay, so the total capacity would be about 2.6 in terms
2.
Of.
2.5. 2.5. Roughly about 60%. 60% of the capacity.
No, no. What I'm working at, therefore, is what is the EBITDA per ton that you will make? And therefore, will it be comfortably above your interest outgo?
Yes, the EBITDA per ton, if you look at our numbers, it were more than 9,000 rupees per ton EBITDA. And going forward also, it will remain in the same range. But in fact, in the last quarter of the financial year, it should actually go up. Simply because once we start the BOF operation, then our cost will come down substantially. And we do expect that EBITDA number to go up.
EBITDA will go to what, 9,500?
We expect it to go up at least by the 1,000 rupees or so, maybe a little more than that.
Okay, so the question of meeting your 950 crore interest payment quarterly will not be an issue hereafter?
No, certainly not. I mean, that's the most important thing that we are working on. And, we have, in addition to our own improvement and the earnings from the plant, we also have other plans, so to speak, to make sure that the debt level is maintained at a comfortable level.
Yeah.
And we're already working on it, including, monetizing some of the non-core assets and so on. We're underway, but these are all, work in progress. So at the moment, we are not in a position to talk too much about that.
No, I mean, yeah, I know that is your power assets that you were monetizing. So I wasn't sure whether you will give us an update. Will anything be monetized in this fiscal itself? We were awaiting the deal with JSW Energy.
Yes, the JSW deal, I know that there are a lot of discussions which are happening in the media in terms of JSW deal. The fact is that power business nowadays practically in the entire India is not doing so well, simply because the coal non-availability as well as the PPA issues which are there. But having said that, this deal with JSW is still very much on the table, and because the dates which are there is up to March end, and we are very hopeful that by that time we will come to a conclusion in this.
Okay, just give us an overall number. I think yours is 45,000 crore debt for the entire unit. What will it be, say, at the end of FY19?
As of now, you know, let me just put it like that, that we just want to make sure that all the repayments, etc., are done as per the plan and so on. So that's what we're really focusing on to make sure. And in the subsequent years, we will certainly look forward to further reducing it. But right now, we have all the plans to make sure that all the repayments are done in time.
Okay. All right. We'll leave it at that. Thank you very much, Mr. Ansari, for joining us and joining us on a big day for us. It's our 18th birthday as well. Well, we are 18 years and one day old. Thank you very much for joining us.
Okay, well, that was the word coming in from JSPL. The market is actually picking up some more pace now, so keep an eye out on that. The mid-caps are doing very well, up almost 0.7%. And a lot of interesting mid-caps. We spoke about how names like Tata Power are up almost about 2.5%. Petronet LNG is up almost about 4%. And JSW Energy has picked up pace too. Yeah. And Jet Airways, ahead of its earnings, is looking good.
Yeah, but you know, just the high of the day is 10,104.85. Yesterday's high was 10,104. So absolutely same. I don't know. I mean, let's see. We have now made a first hour high. If that first hour high is taken out, maybe some more short covering. But 10,105 sort of important level to watch out for now.
Okay, that's useful, Anuj. Always better if you look only for a number and not ranges. But commodity space has given us a lot of pain. Manish Agupta is joining us to tell us whether that pain is also getting relieved in the early morning trends. Manisha?
It is, and a bit really, Lata. If you look at the crude oil prices, well, after the very sharp declines that we saw overnight, especially after the U.S. weekly inventory data, we seem to be seeing some opportunity buying on the lower side for both the crude varieties. The Indian markets, of course, still reacting to the kind of very sharp declines that we saw even after the New York excess trade was on. So we were down 2 to 3% overnight. We still are trading at multi-week lows into the global markets there. But there is so much to watch out for as we go ahead. Mostly it is a higher weightages that the markets are talking about giving in case of crude oil prices in the first couple of quarters in 2018. You are looking at the OPEC and allies cut, and that really has yielded good results in sense of global supplies and prices also. But on the other side, it really has been about US. The weekly output in US is at a record high of 9.7 million barrels per day. And it also has to do with the increase in fuel, the distillate and the energy product supplies, which have been gaining. That, of course, has been putting pressure on prices. The gold and silver prices continue to trade within a range and, of course, making lower lows on charts there. The dollar index is trading at a two-week highs, and until that continues to be strong, you will see that pressure continuing in case of the gold and silver prices. So flat to negative is how we are trading on that one. It is the base metal space, of course, which has been making news, and copper prices, after declining 7% in last 8 to 10 trading sessions, have seen some buying interest come back, so 0.25% up on that. But it really has to do with the steel ingredients, which actually have seen a bit of a turnaround come in. So you have the nickel and zinc prices trading 0.5% on the higher side. But mind you, we have been making lower lows on charts on this one as well. The open interest has been declining, so that tells you that the long positions actually are going in for unwinding, and you are looking at volume thinning as we head towards the year end. Trading strategies, and we have them from Grow Value. They actually have a buy call on the lower side for the intraday markets today. For the natural gas prices, they're expecting a buy with 197 on the higher side today. They also have come out with a contrarian call buy on the metal space as well. For copper, they're looking at an upside of 436, and zinc as well is a buy call with 212 as a target for the intraday markets.
Okay, Manisha, thanks as always for giving us that update. We